airline cabin crews first took to the air 60 years ago, they've captured the imagination of the American public.
It was a glamorous job, and it was considered the glamour job in a glamour industry. And people would look at stewardesses in uniform as something just almost out of another world, the way people look at astronauts now, I guess.
The history of flight attendants and the largest union that represents them, the Association of Flight Attendants, helps tell the story of the struggles and triumphs of women in the workplace over the last 60 years. Before 1930, people who wanted to fly got into planes that carried no more than 10 people. If there was any service during the trip, it was provided by the pilot, or on rare occasions, a male steward. Then a young woman who yearned to be a pilot approached Boeing Air Transport executive Stephen Stimson with the idea of women as cabin attendants. Ellen Church became the first woman crew member for a commercial airline.
I was the first stewardess employed by Boeing, which later became part of United Airlines. My initial assignment was to recruit seven other girls. I hired three in San Francisco and four in Chicago, all registered nurses, and we began flying in May. Here's an old picture showing us in our new uniforms. Very stylish at the time, shower cap berets. The plane was a tri-motor Boeing, enormous then, but a pygmy compared with today's jets. It carried 14 passengers. As I recall, I cruised at about 125 miles an hour. Being a stewardess was rather rugged at the beginning. There were times when some of the girls even helped to refuel the plane. Now, I remember standing out on the wings once or twice, pressing some gadget or other while the co-pilot sat at the engines.
Because Ellen Church was a woman, she was never to become a pilot. But she and Stephen Stimson created a new occupation for women, the airline flight attendant. In those days, they were called sky girls. They were required to be registered nurses, not over 25 years old, no taller than 5'4", and no heavier than 115 pounds. They were paid $125 a month for 100 hours of flying. At first, there was grumbling from a few of the pilots about women in the air. They claimed they were too busy in the cockpit to look after a helpless woman on the crew. Boeing Air Transport claimed the pilots' wives were nervous about single women working so closely with their husbands, so the company made a rule barring stewardesses from talking to pilots unless it was work-related. Within a few years, other airlines followed United's lead and also hired stewardesses.
We left Chicago here about an hour ago and flew right along here. And now if you look out the window, you can begin to see Detroit below us.
Oh, very look.
Yep.
Extremely conscious of the public's fear of flying in the early years, the airlines promoted an image of stability, comfort, and safety to the traveling public.
Captain Butler, this is Mr. and Mrs. Toll.
How do you do? You folks enjoying your trip?
Oh, I think it's wonderful.
Well, that's fine. Breakfast. That's another nice thing about air travel. At mealtime, delicious, well-cooked food appears before you with the compliments of the airline.
Smart-looking girl. I hear they're all graduate nurses.
When you were hired, you had a physical. Before that, you were interviewed. You'd lift up your skirt so they could look at your legs. And just your general looks and qualifications. You couldn't be heavy, but they didn't.
Shortly after she finished her nursing degree, Ada Brown became a stewardess for United Airlines in 1940.
It was new and it was small, and every time you went on a trip it was an adventure, especially in the wintertime because you never know if you might have to stay.
When America became involved in World War II, nurses were needed elsewhere. The airlines still required college degrees, but their stewardesses were no longer strictly nurses. Right after she finished her political science degree, Edith Lauterbach became a stewardess. It was 1944, and the war was raging.
There were many very traumatic situations. And maybe a wife was being sent back when her husband had to go overseas, and it was a very wrenching separation, and she didn't know whether he's going to come back or not. And
although flying maintained its glamorous image, Edie recalls there were harsh realities to be faced in air cabins without pressurization.
Those little planes, when in the summer when there were thunderstorms, in the winter when there were rainstorms, winter snowstorms, those planes were all over the sky. So we'd be running up and down the aisle serving meals at 14,000 feet without oxygen. After we flew a while, we realized it wasn't nearly as glamorous when we had to crawl on our hands and knees to deliver meals to people in rough air and to clean up, you know, after them when they got airsick and to hold their hands and to take care of them.
But when a stewardess went off duty, there was no one there to hold her hand. The airlines had a strict rule. If a stewardess got married, she was automatically fired.
That, of course, restricted people's personal lives tremendously. And many, many people would have liked to keep on flying.
Several of the girls were married, and they were always afraid of being caught.
The no marriage rule and the rough work schedule helped make stewardessing a high turnover position. But those who stayed with it for a while knew something needed to be done to improve conditions.
We had had to sit on airplanes and in way stations along the way all over the country with passengers for hours and hours at a time. When there was a mechanical delay, a weather delay, we were required to stay with the passengers, never paid for it.
We had no rights, put it that way. We were at the company's mercy.
Ada Brown set out to organize the first union for flight attendants. The pilots were among the first white-collar workers to form a union, the Airline Pilots Association. They'd organized back in 1931 and were willing to help out the stewardesses. Edie Lauterbach was quick to join the organizing drive.
Seniority at that time was average 9 months. So you can imagine how difficult it was to try to get people to sign up and get a majority of your workforce signed up on these Railway Labor Act cards.
You had to get them fast and had to get them signed up. And you had to be very careful about not mentioning union. You had to call it an association because nobody wanted a union.
Most of them came from families where the daddy just didn't want his daughter to be in a union.
But within 2 months, the volunteer organizers signed up 75% of United Stewardesses, and the first union of airline cabin crew members was born, the Airline Stewardesses Association. In April 1946, United President William A. Patterson finally agreed to sign a contract with the stewardesses.
We got a lot of things that they're still using today.
Seniority was one victory that Ada Brown would not have long to enjoy. In 1947, at age 30, she fell victim to the no marriage rule and was forced to leave her profession. 2 years later, United hired men as cabin crew members on its Hawaiian routes. Unlike their female counterparts, they were allowed to be married and have families. In 1949, the stewardesses at United became part of the pilots' union. Though the stewardesses' union may not have survived without the pilots, the women had to push the male pilots for autonomy and the right to determine their own issues at the bargaining table. By 1952, the government required airlines to have flight attendants because of safety. But the real change in the profession came with the onset of jet air travel.
The screeching in of the jet age had to be one of the biggest changes that flight attendants faced. Our numbers doubled. We could go from coast to coast in half the time with twice the passengers.
Georgia Nielsen became a stewardess in 1960 and is still a flight attendant today.
When I started flying, we were expected by my company, by United, to be rather the girl next door, the type of woman that, or girls as they called us then, that our passengers might like to take home to meet their mother and to marry them.
Susan, would you like a junior stewardess pin?
Oh, yes, thank you.
And how would you like to be a junior pilot?
Oh, I'd love to.
The expectations were quite conservative, too. Our behavior was rather monitored, and nice women did certain things. We wore white gloves, for example.
One 1960s air passenger commented, "Stewardesses are America's Vestal Virgins." The Vestal Virgins of the air were not expected to stay beyond the usual tenure of 18 months before they found suitable husbands.
You sit down in the seat right here and I'll demonstrate some of our features.
Would you do that for me?
Push this little button here. Lean back.
Taking a lever often meant termination. A pregnant stewardess had two options: give up the baby for adoption or obtain an illegal abortion.
Take me along if you love me. Take me along if you love me. Take me along with
me. I love you, a little cutie, but the office is my duty.
My
air travel was changing dramatically, and so were the country's mores. Stewardesses became a symbol for some of those changes.
As time went on, exploitation surfaced in the 60s after I started flying, and I looked around and our skirts were getting shorter, mine too, and at the same time I was getting older and something was happening. In the 1960s, National Airlines came forth with one of the worst ads. It said things like, "I'm Cheryl, fly me," or "I'm Georgia, fly me," or whatever the person's name. These were real people that they used. That was a very painful time for many of us, because about the same time we were suddenly becoming a little more aware of where we were in American society and where we felt we needed to be.
Graduation day at United Stewardess College.
I hate to wake you up to say goodbye, but the dawn is breaking. It's early morning.
It's a happy day for the girls and their parents.
I'm so excited.
The 1965 Civil Rights Act would have a tremendous impact on the lives of flight attendants. Although most carriers relaxed the no marriage rule in the late 60s, it was not until the 1970s, through litigation based on the Civil Rights Act, that women flight attendants firmly won the right to be married and keep their jobs. The Stewardess Union, started at United in 1946, helped win many of the battles against discrimination that would change the profession. They remained part of the Airline Pilots Association until 1984, when they received their own charter from the AFL-CIO. Susan Bianchi Sand is president of AFA, the Association of Flight Attendants.
Our history is that we were in unions dominated by men, and we left those unions for one reason or another. Not really because they were dominated by men, but because they were dominated by non-flight attendants. So we took our own destiny into our hands and created our own union.
No longer young stewardesses, they are flight attendants, women and men of all colors who may continue flying into their 60s.
I can remember beginning working in 1969 when it was actually someone came over and poked me in the side to see if I had a girdle on. I don't think that would happen today.
I think there's many important things that AFA has done for its members today. You can be pregnant and fly, you can be female, you can be black, you could be Asian, you could be male, you can be 20, you can be 70. We are very safety oriented. We've got a respect now from the, I think from the industry, from the consumers, from the management.
I'm a safety professional.
I can make your flight comfortable for you, and I hope I make your flight comfortable for you, but I'm basically there for your safety.
Recent experience in airline accidents has reaffirmed the crucial role flight attendants play in passenger safety.
Six flight attendants showed the world that our job is safety, and that's our number one job. They reminded the traveling public, the media, the industry, and the government why we are on the aircraft, why we fight so hard for a crash-worthy airplane interior, and why we want better training, flight time, duty time rules, and certification for flight attendants.
That's, you know, do the
Etta Beering is in-flight services manager for United Airlines in San Francisco.
The captain is, of course, in the cockpit, but during a flight, the flight attendants are the only one really in charge.
Please follow along as we point out the exits on board. At the forward part of the aircraft, we have two-door exits.
They're highly trained for that, and they take recurrent training every year, and they take that very, very seriously. And they really make a difference. I mean, we don't take them for granted, but we do count on them, and they always come through.
When I started, I thought I'd fly a year and then be, it was a big glamorous job for a year, and then I quit. 42 years later, I'm finally retired.
You get a great satisfaction in thinking that you were there to help start something that carried on for so many years and needed done.